They burst onto the pop scene in the 70s, a band of brothers from Utah who took the world by storm.
They were the Mormon Beatles. They were bigger than big.
They sold more than 80 million records and broke countless hearts on their way to building an empire unlike any in show business history.
They are far and away the most gifted vocal group I've ever seen. To me, there'll never be another Osmonds.
The Osmonds' show business legacy spans more than four decades. Their remarkable longevity is a testament to their family unity. To them, everything is relative.
Well, I think that's the reason why we've been able to stay together in such a crazy business, is that we kept our family first. Everything else was secondary, but as long as we could maintain family unity, then everything else stayed in its own perspective.
The sprawling Osmond brood includes 9 children, 51 grandchildren, 7 great-grandchildren, and counting. The roots of this giant oak of a family tree were planted in January 1944, when Sergeant George Osmond met Olive Davis, a civilian worker at an Army depot in Ogden, Utah.
He walked in with that uniform on, and my heart just did a flip-flop. The next day, I gave him 2 scoops of ice cream when he came through the line, and I got a wink.
By the end of that year, the couple married at the Mormon Temple in Salt Lake City and settled in Ogden. True to their faith, they planned to raise a large family, but reality put the newlyweds' dream to an early test. Their first 2 children, sons Verl and Tom, were diagnosed as severely hearing impaired.
Mom and Dad, they spent a horrendous amount of hours going drilling with me, helping me to speak properly. I was mainstreamed into public school. It was difficult for me because in those days, hearing aid boxes were rather large, and you had to wear them with straps, and you had a plug going up to stick out of your ears.
The Osmonds believed they could meet any challenge as long as they faced it together. Despite doctors' warnings that deafness could occur again, George and Olive put their faith in God and had 4 more sons. First Alan, then Wayne, Merrill, and little Jay. To support the growing household, George worked 3 jobs as an insurance salesman, real estate broker, and post office supervisor. At home, however, he remained the Army sergeant and regarded the boys as his troops. They slept in a barrack-like room and awoke to reveille.
Our lifestyle at home was very hard. My father found things for us to do. We had a huge farm of sugar beets we'd hoe every morning just to keep us busy. It was that Army mentality and thing of keep them off the streets, keep them working.
When they weren't working hard on the farm, the Osmonds took family trips. While driving to Yellowstone National Park, they first discovered they enjoyed harmonizing together.
We were on our way to Yellowstone. Our father was singing, and then my brother Alan kind of chimed in, started singing, and we all just kind of did that together, and it started there, basically.
Encouraged by what he heard, George began training his boys to sing multi-part harmony in the style of a barbershop quartet, right down to the synchronized hand movements and smiling faces. Their first performances took place during Family Night, a time Mormons set aside each week to promote togetherness.
After the dinner, we'd have a floor show. We were pretending to be in a fancy hotel or something. Well, the grandparents just ate it up, and so they would work every week. They'd learn a new song so they could sing it for Family Night.
As word of the Osmonds' harmonizing spread, they received invitations to sing at church, social gatherings, and corporate functions throughout Utah.
There definitely was one performance that I'll never forget. My younger brother, Jay, was up there singing along with us. Well, he was blowing it. He just couldn't get his act together, and the people started to laugh and started to throw money. Well, rather than keeping with the group, he was out there picking up all the cash.
I'd come home with big pocketfuls of money, and it was really funny. And the more I did it, the more people threw. I thought, this is a great way to get paid.
The Osmonds used the money they earned to cover their older brother's mission work. Singing was just their hobby, not yet their profession. Still, demand for the Osmonds grew. They appeared at everything from a conference of regional governors to a convention for the Society for the Preservation of Barbershop Quartets, where they impressed the pros.
The Osmonds were the most special young group I've ever seen or heard or worked with. They had this beautiful intonation, the ability to sing in tune, not flatting, not sharping, singing right on the notes, and barbershop harmony demands that.
The early harmonies of the Osmonds are captured in their first film performance, shot at a Salt Lake City TV studio in 1960.
We're the Osmond Brothers Quartet. We love to sing, you bet. So hello to everyone. Hi there!
By 1962, the Osmonds were singing around the country at barbershop harmony shows. During a swing through the Los Angeles area, they befriended the Lennon sisters, whom they asked to arrange an audition for Lawrence Welk. But the famous band leader declined. He didn't want an amateur group like the Osmonds on his TV show. The Lennons were determined to help the quartet and asked their uncle, who promoted locally televised boxing matches, to put the boys on between bouts. They were anything but a knockout.
We walked out there. We sang a little song, and it got very noisy. Get off the stage, boo, we want the fights. And boy, we were a little intimidated. My mother said, if this is what show business is about, we don't want anything to do with it. So we went out with our tail between our legs, and we said, come on, let's go home to Utah.
Before going home, the Osmonds went to Disneyland to lift their spirits. It proved to be a decisive detour. There, they met the Dapper Dans, a barbershop quartet performing on Main Street. The Osmonds sang them a song that impressed not only the group, but the crowd that gathered around them. The impromptu performance led to an audition for Walt Disney himself.
We get to this audition, and there's Walt Disney, about as close as you are to me. I was so nervous that I messed up the hat routine totally. I got my mustache caught, and I stepped on Meryl's foot, and Walt Disney fell off his chair. He was laughing so hard, and he came up to me and gave me a big hug after that, and he said, don't ever change.
Ladies and gentlemen, from Ogden, Utah, the Osmond Brothers.
Disney hired the Osmonds to perform at the park that summer and gave them a spot on Disneyland After Dark, a TV program showcasing the talent there.
I'm Alan.
I'm Wayne.
I'm Meryl.
I'm Jay, and I'm 6 years old.
I'm 8.
I'm 10.
I'm 12 years old, and I'm the bass.
I'm the baritone.
I'm the tenor.
I'm the lead.
Among those watching the show was Jay Williams, the father of singer Andy Williams, who had his own TV variety show. The Osmonds reminded Jay of Andy and his brothers when they sang as boys. Realizing the Osmonds' potential, Jay introduced them to Andy.
Now we're here to
we were so nervous. There he was, Andy Williams, you know, with those big blue eyes of his, you know, and everything. It's just like, you know, us tiny little kids sitting there, and we were really nervous.
I stopped the rehearsals, and we listened to them sing. And it was funny, because they were so young. And they sang barbershop harmony. That's all they did. I mean, we just broke up. And then my father says, see, they're great, aren't they? And I said, yeah, they really are wonderful. And he said, well, you're going to put them on your show. And I said, well, we'll talk about it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Osmond Brothers.
We're the Osmond Brothers Boys Quartet.
In December 1962, the Osmonds made their national television debut on the Andy Williams Show.
And the reaction was so terrific. Jay was the youngest, and he followed the camera. And it was funny. And it got to be a comedy act. And the reaction to them from that one appearance was so terrific that we asked him to come back the next week.
After their second appearance, fan mail poured into the Andy Williams Show requesting more of those barbershop brothers from Utah. Williams offered them a 5-year deal. It was a tempting proposition. It promised instant stardom, yet it also meant giving up the only life they had known and relocating the entire family, which now included 2 more children, Donnie and Marie, to Los Angeles, a city with far different values than their own. During a family night, they all gathered to make their momentous decision.
They were given a choice, and they chose this entertainment field. It was their decision, but we wanted to please them and find an occupation that they'd enjoy, and this happened to be music.